Hello, this is Srihari again, and the topic of discussion today will be the Kalpit Brook operation. So this particular topic will be discussed under varieties of headings like indications and contraindications, instruments used, procedure, post-operative care, and the complications. So as the name indicates, this procedure was introduced by two scientists. One is George Calvell, and next one is going to be Henry Luke in the year 1897. This procedure is nearly 120 years old, but still this one remains the classic approach for your maxillary sinus. So obviously we will start with the procedure so that it will be easy for you to understand the other headings in that topic. So let us start with the procedure, step-by-step approach for the Calvell-Luke operation. So this is step-by-step approach to the Calvell-Luke operation. So obviously, as other operations, the first step will be the administration of the local anesthesia. So either you can prefer local anesthesia with conscious sedation, or you can even prefer general anesthesia for doing this procedure. Right after administering the anesthetics, then obviously you have to go for the initial incision. Remember, this Calvell-Luke operation is an intraoral procedure. That means you are going to create a window or a hole in the canine fossa right above your canine tooth. You are going to gain access into the sinus through that particular window. But now we will be having a doubt, why do we select this particular region for drainage of the maxillary sinus? It is because of the fact that the anteroposterior wall of the sinus is going to be the thinnest in this canine fossa. The anteroposterior wall of the sinus is thinnest in the canine fossa. So it is easy to create a window here and to gain access into the maxillary antrum. So first we are going to identify the canine fossa, then we are going for the initial incision. So remember three points about initial incision. First is the instrument used and the shape. The instrument used will be your BP blade number 11. Will be used for the initial incision, and the shape will be a semilunar incision. Number two will be the extension. Obviously, the semilunar incision, can you see here in this picture? This semilunar incision will be extending from the canine tooth to the second molar tooth. So the incision will be a semilunar shaped incision extending from the canine tooth to the second molar tooth. And always remember that when you give an incision, that incision should be always larger than the window that you are going to be creating later. So always you have to plan. If your window is going to be of nearly 2 or 3 centimeter in size, always your incision should be larger than that particular window. These are the three criteria in creating the initial incision in the canine fossa. Definitely right after giving that particular semilunar incision, you will be having the mucoperiosteal flap covering the bone. So you have to detach the mucoperiosteal flap and you have to retract that to visualize the bone. So while retracting and detaching this mucoperiosteal flap with the help of an elevator, always remember not to injure a particular nerve in this particular area. So what is that nerve? It will be the superior labial branch of the infraorbital nerve. So care should be taken not to injure this particular nerve, that is your superior labial branch of the infraorbital nerve, which will be near to your canine fossa. Usually that will supply a part of your upper lip, also your cheek and the facial skin area in that particular site. So always care should be taken not to injure this particular nerve. Now the incision is given, mucoperiosteal flap is elevated, now the bone is clearly visible. Obviously you are going to create a window, a small hole through which you can gain access into the maxillary sinus. So you will not be able to directly create a large window in the bone. So first of all, you have to create a small hole at the center of the canine fossa. For that, you will use an instrument called as gauge. So what you see here is the gauge. So first, this gauge will be helpful to create a small hole or a center perforation at the canine fossa. Right after that, you have to increase the size of the central perforation, because that small hole will not be sufficient enough to drain the antral pathology. Also, there won't be a good accessibility into the particular sinus. So obviously, you have to enlarge this with the help of an instrument called as Rongius. So Rongius will be helpful for that. So first, gauge will be used to create a central perforation. Now, to increase the size of the central perforation, your Rongius will be used. Now, the central perforation has been enlarged so that at least your index finger can get enter into that particular window. That should be the minimal size, because you are supposed to insert your index finger into the antrum and palpate the sinus walls and see if there is any residual amounts of pathology which is going to be left over after this operation. So make sure that your antral window preparation is large enough to insert your index finger. This is the criteria for creating the window. That means it should be large enough to enter into your antrum by your index finger. And number two, it is done by two steps: first creating a central perforation and then enlarging it with the help of your bronchioles. Then after that, obviously you have to go for drainage. Now the antrum is visible. We'll be able to see the antral tumors or any kind of mucoceles or any kind of cyst or any kind of mycotic fungal balls. Like in case of mucormycosis, you'll be able to see the infective substance inside the antrum. So now all these have to be drained. So for that, we'll use something called as aspirator. So what you see here, it is called as aspirator. So this aspirator will be used to drain all the antral pathological stuff. So right after the aspiration, you have to irrigate the particular antrum with the help of normal saline. Use the normal saline, irrigate that particular antrum. Now you are going to repeat this process. Drain all the antral pathological stuff and irrigate it. And then finally, if you are sure that all the pathological stuff have been removed, use this particular instrument called as nasopharyngoscope. This nasopharyngoscope is used to illuminate the antral walls, because there will be a small light coming out of this particular nasopharyngoscope. So thereby we will be able to visualize the antrum clearly. In case if you have left out some kind of foreign body such as cotton or strips of gauze, or if you would have missed out some kind of roots of some tooth in case of a root impacted into the maxillary sinus. So everything can be visualized easily and you can able to remove that out of the maxillary sinus. So obviously, again, after removing all the residual stuff, just go for a final irrigation. So by using your normal saline, you will be able to irrigate this particular stuff. So drainage is by the help of the aspirator. Irrigation with normal saline, obviously you have to remove all the irrigating solution also with the help of the aspirator. After the drainage and irrigation procedure is done, you have to go for inspection with the help of the nasopharyngoscope. Now the antrum is devoid of any pathological stuff. And if you are able to see any kind of lining epithelium, inflammatory lining epithelium or the granulomatous tissue adherent to the tissue wall or this antral wall, you have to use the curette. This curette will be helpful for removing all the inflammatory granulation tissue which is adherent to that of your antral wall. So obviously all these processes are done. Now the entire antrum is devoid of any pathology. So finally you have to just take a strip of gauze, just dip it in the antibiotic paste and just fill the antrum with that particular gauze, and finally you can go for the closure. That means you can just keep the mucoperiosteal flap at the right position. You can able to suture with the intrepid sutures. And right after 2 days itself, you will be just removing that particular stripped gauze which is kept inside the antrum. Now, after nearly 1 week, the antrum will be completely healed and the patients will go for the normal functions. So this is how the Caldwell look operation is done. This is a step-by-step approach for the Caldwell look operation. So from this procedure itself, you will be able to write what are the instruments that can be used for this procedure. Now you can tell me, right? So what are the instruments? The first instrument will be the BP plate, obviously. Then you should need some elevators for elevating the mucoperiosteal flap. And for the creation of window, you need something called as gauge and bronchioles. So instead of bronchioles, you can use something called as Kerrison's forceps also. So either bronchioles or you can use Kerrison's forceps. So these are used for creating the windows. Right after that, for the drainage purpose, you need aspirator. Then you need something called as normal saline or some kind of irrigating solutions. Then you need nasopharyngoscope for the inspection purpose. Then you need some antibiotic paste and gauze for filling the antrum. Then you need some suture materials and all for final suturing processes. So all these are instruments used. Now coming to the indications. What are the indications for Caldwell look operation? So obviously I told you that this is the classical approach for gaining access into the maxillary sinus. So obviously the indications of these operations includes, number one, any kind of tumors in the sinus that should be either benign or malignant. So benign tumors includes your amyloblastoma and all those stuff, whatever we have discussed in the last lecture. And even for malignant cases, we can go for Carl-Willock operation. But remember that if it is going to have some posterior spread or superior spread, or if it is going to have some sinus spread, for example, if the tumor is going to be of an antroethmoidal origin, obviously the Carl-Willock operation is not that perfect for these procedures. We have to go for some other procedure called as FESS, functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Okay, otherwise, if the tumor is restricted towards the medial wall, or if it is restricted towards the inferior wall, then obviously you can easily go for this Carl-Willock operation, because usually you can gain access into the antrum through two ways. One is through the intraoral way, that is the preparation of window in the canine fossa, and the second one is through your nasal cavity. So even you can perforate the nasoantral wall for the drainage in this surgery. So obviously the medial wall and the inferior wall tumors can be easily managed by the help of your Carl-Willock operation. Number two, any foreign body inside the sinus. The most common stuff will be the removal of tooth or any other fragments of roots or the impacted tooth inside the antrum. So if it is maxillary tooth, then obviously it have more tendency to just slip into the antrum. So in those cases, for the removal of foreign bodies or to remove the teeth or the fragments of the roots, obviously you can go for this Carl-Willock operation. And excision of any kind of cyst that is extending into the maxillary sinus. So the excision of cyst also, you can use this Carl-Willock operation. And for antrolith, if you're going to have any calcifications inside the sinus, it is called as antrolith. And for any kind of fungal infections, you know that mucormycosis, especially the rhinocerebral form of mucormycosis, is very commonly invading the maxillary sinus. So for that purpose, you can remove the mycotic fungal balls with the help of this Carl-Willock operation. So any kind of fungal balls, especially in case of your mucormycosis. Then in cases of recurrent epistaxis control, and in cases of oroantral fistula closure, and in cases of management of any hematoma inside the sinus, and even in case of some facial fractures where there will be displacement of some kind of bones or bony fragments into the sinus, we can go for this Carl-Willock operation. So all these are indications for Carl-Willock procedure. Coming to contraindications, there is no specific contraindication for this procedure, but care should be taken while doing this procedure in children, especially when they are going to be in the mixed dentition state. Because in the canine fossa, obviously they will be having their primary canine tooth here, and obviously you can able to see the permanent canine tooth but near the canine fossa region. So while perforating or creating a window, care should be taken not to injure this particular developing tooth bud. If you injure that, then definitely it will affect the dentition of the particular child. So usually Carl-Willock operation is avoided in young children where mixed dentition is present. So this is the only contraindication. And in case of simple sinusitis where pharmacologic therapy can help the patient, you are not supposed to go for surgery. These are the two precautions that you have to take before doing Carl-Willock operation in those people. Apart from that, in most of the antral pathologies, you can safely do Carl-Willock procedure. Now coming to the post-operative care. So what is the post-operative care that you should give to the patient? Number one, obviously after the surgery, you have to prescribe antibiotics and analgesics. That should be given for a period of 5 days to 1 week. Okay, if the pain is going to be persistent or if the patient is going to have any other symptoms, you can even go for prescription about 2 weeks, these antibiotics and your analgesic drugs. Then after that, you have to ask the patient to keep their head up always. Head up position is always better for these people for a period of 2 weeks. And if the patient is going to have any nasal congestion, definitely you are going to prescribe some nasal decongestants for these people. So nasal decongestants, that is for a period of 1 week, obviously. Then obviously regular checkup is needed for these people. And at the second day, they are supposed to come to the clinic and remove the particular antral packing. Because during the operation, they are going to keep an antral packing where we will be keeping a gauze which is going to be dipped with the antibiotic solution. So either through the nasoantral wall or through the intraorally itself, we will be able to remove that particular nasal packing at that second day. After that, definitely within a period of 1 or 2 weeks, they will be going for complete healing. So this is about the post-operative care. And ask the patient not to blow, because while blowing, there are chances for dislodgement of the suture and the flap, what you have done in the intraoral site. So obviously you have to ask the patient not to blow for a period of 2 weeks until the flap has been healed. So all these are about the post-operative care for the people. Now you should know about one important thing called as Denger's operation. See, this is a classical operation for antral pathologies. It is called as Caldwell look operation. So usually, if you see historically, there are two procedures for antral pathologies. One is going to be the Caldwell look operation, and second one is called as Denker's operation. Okay, Denker's operation. The only difference between the Caldwell look operation and Denker's operation is, usually here, in case of Denker's operation, the perforation is extended medially. Means it is this perforation is extended medially to include your nasal aperture also. But this is very complicated because while creating the perforation, extending it into the medial process will always damage the innervations of your anterior tooth. So there are chances for post-operative non-vitality and discoloration of the anterior tooth. Even though it is going to have an advantage that the window will be large enough to remove all the pathological stuff easily, it is going to contain a major disadvantage that it is going to injure the innervations to the anterior tooth, especially the central incisors. So usually this Denker's operation is not performed. There is no need to extend the perforation medially to include the nasal aperture. We can just create a window so that our index finger is going to be inside. That is enough. If you are trying to extend it medially, obviously we are going to make it more complicated by injuring the innervations of the teeth. So sometimes in Viva they can ask you, what is Denker's operation? It is a type of caudal look surgery where it is extended medially in case of extensive lesions for better accessibility and vision into the maxillary sinus. So this is a modification of the caudal look operation, but usually we are not doing this. And again, nowadays the incidence of doing this particular operation is very less because we have some other procedure called as functional endoscopic sinus surgery that I will be discussing at the next video. It is usually done nowadays in the clinics. So now we have completed about the indications and contraindications, instruments used, procedure, the step-by-step approach for the Caldwell look operation, post-operative care, and the finally left out stuff is going to be the complications. So from the procedure itself, you will be able to tell me the complications, right? Number one, obviously, while elevating the mucoperiosteal flap, there is a chance for injuring the superior infraorbital nerve. That is the first complication. Accidental injury to the branches of infraorbital nerve while elevating the mucoperiosteal flap. Number two, obviously, you can, for like any surgery, you can get hemorrhages or epistaxis, bleeding through the nose. And sometimes you can able to cut the innervations to the canine tooth or the tooth in that particular region. So obviously you can go for post-operative discoloration or non-vitality of the tooth. So care should be taken not to affect any innervations of the maxillary teeth area. Then obviously sometimes if you are not going to irrigate the canal properly or if you are not going to drain the particular antrum properly, it can result in recurrence of the lesion. That is also very common. So all these are complications. So infraorbital nerve injury, prevention or the post-operative anesthesia or paresthesia of the maxillary tooth area, and epiphora. Sometimes there can be obstruction to the tear gland, so you can have epiphora due to the blockage of the tear duct. You can have any kind of tooth root fractures, especially canine tooth. It is very long. You can able to make some fractures or accidental cuts in the root of the tooth. Then you can go for recurrences, and you can even go for some nasal bleeding or hemorrhages, or sometimes infections. Because of poor wound healing, you can go for infections, intraoral infections, halitosis, etc. So that's all about the Caldwell look operation. So it is an important short note for you. So kindly learn this particular topic. So obviously, if you understood the topic, please click the like button. So wait for the next video. I will be talking on functional endoscopic sinus surgery.